星期三的晚上被雷森福音到达台湾以后，我们有两天的时间相处。我觉得很有趣的时候，就常常外国人来的时候都想看观光，但是费雷斯来的时候一直跟我们讲说，我要知道人民怎么生活。所以他住在旅馆的时候，他早上五点钟就起来，到因为他住在中立市中心，他就去看，因为他说劳动阶级的人民就是早上活动的，他就观察到，他说中立地区啊，五点到七点之间都是蓝领阶级的工人在火车站这一带，七点以后是学生，八点以后是明显的上班族。你们大概从来都没想过这件事情，但是这个人在到达台湾的第一个早上就已经一个人在中立地区走了一两个钟头去观察社会去了。那我觉得这个也给我一个很大的激励，就是对我们必须要认识社会，我们才能找到改变社会的路。那我就不做多做介绍，我们就请 Leslie Fanger。
好胖，好胖！
他不是说我好胖，他说好棒。
早安，你们好吗？
好。
我的名字是费雷斯。我很高兴在这儿，我很好，谢谢你们。I know I sing very poorly in Mandarin, but I know where I stand, and I respect who I'm with. I respect my hosts at this conference. I thank everyone.Who brought me to stand this first time in my life in Taiwan, this first time in my life in Asia. A working class child in the United States who grows up poor does not expect to travel to Asia, is not expected to write a book or to come and meet you and shake your hand and say to you,你好吗? I want to devote my remarks today to the spirit of Tai Ya Ting. This is a precious life that was our gift, that is still our gift, but we must continue to carry forward in our lives.
我的中文不好，不过我非常清楚地知道我的立场是什么。我也很尊重在场跟我一起的朋友们。谢谢那些使得我能够这次成型的努力工作的人。作为一个劳动阶级的子女，我其实从来没有期待我能够出国旅行，能够到亚洲，也从来没有想过我能够写书，我能够来这里跟大家握手。但是今天早上我的演讲，我希望能够把它献给我蔡雅婷以及蔡雅婷所代表的最基本的奋战的精神。蔡雅婷的生命是我们的珍宝，我们要珍惜它，而且要继续她没有完成的工作。
To my Japanese friends, konnichiwa. And to my 同学 Minnie Bruce Pratt.It is my great honor to be traveling here together. Please allow me to express my deep gratitude to Dr. Ho. First, because I'm so aware that my words could not travel from my lips.To your ears without her very skilled labor of this very esteemed and distinguished researcher and theoretician and ally.
Mason. 发他觉得很高兴，也很感谢这些出了力做了事的人，像翻译的朋友们，谢谢大家。其他你们听懂就算了。
And I apologize if this puts Dr. Ho on the spot, but I am aware and gravely concerned about her prosecution.And I want to express my very deep and unwavering support for Dr. Ho. And just as she is laboring to help my voice be heard today, I will continue to work hard to make sure that her voice is heard every day.
He 他也表示他全心的支持，就像我们的工作使得很多边缘的声音，包括他的声音能够被大家听见，他也会继续让我们台湾的边缘的声音被世界听见。
Dr. Ho did a lot of work to bring me here, and she did all this work twice. At great effort, she organized to bring me here the first time.And I became gravely ill. And when I was forced to cancel that trip, I learned a lot about Dr. Ho's character, about her humanity, because of the generosity of kindness and compassion she offered me at a moment when all her hard work was being undone.
我跟他讲说先演讲了，反正因为我们整个过程经过过两次申请经费，我真的好幸运啊，我们两次都申请到他的旅费都没问题，虽然他生病取消行程，而且取消是在当时我们开会前在将近一个礼拜左右，但是我们还不错，发挥了中国人耐操耐劳的本事，所以很耐心的，而且我们不断的把我们这边的资讯，我们当时在新大约翰堂开会的这个内容以及实况，我们都把照片把内容都写给他，告诉他说当时我们在场子上面讨论一些什么事情，对跨性别议题讲了一些什么，所以这部分的话我们把我们的希望转为了力量，也终于等到他今天到了。
In Yiddish, the language of Jewish people fromEastern Europe, the highest compliment you can pay to someone is to say they are a mensch, a mensch. It means they are a genuine, real human being. And I thank Dr. Ho for being a mensch. 谢谢。
他
说
的我是个真正的人。
I want to introduce myself to you to tell you a little bit about my life and about why the struggle for sexual and gender liberation is so important to me and why I believe that these important battles are tied with a thousand threads to the movement to liberate humankind from economic exploitation.
我想要先开始谈一下我自己个人的生命历程，要谈一下为什么我的这些为性权的奋斗有这样的重要性。我也想显示这样一些重要的这个征战，跟和其他的为了克服经济剥削的解放运动有什么样的关联。
I was born in the United States in 1949, the year of the ox.Long after the first wave of women's rights movement had won the right to vote, and more than a decade and a half before the second wave of feminist liberation that fought for women arose.
我是1949年牛年出生的，昨天才问我。在第一波女性主义已经为女人争取到投票权之后，但是在第二波女性主义争取更多的解放之前，
grew up in an industrial city, not so different from Zhongli, in Buffalo, New York, in the 1950s. I was a girl child in an economic system that devalued girls and women. My father was a factory worker. Women, particularly butch women, were losing jobs in the factories that they had worked in during World War II when the men came back from overseas. When I was a child, the post-World War II job categories for women were only two, homemaker or mother.
我成长的地方是纽约州的水牛城，在1950年代，那个城市工业城有点像中立一样，以蓝领为主。 在那个年代当中，女孩子非常的被重视，非常的重男轻女。我的父亲在工厂工作，当时50年代在这个四五年二次大战之后，美国的从军的这些男人回到国内以后，所有原来在工厂工作替代男人位置的阳刚女人以及女人，都失去了工作。在那个时候，一个女人她唯一的前途就是要不就做主妇。
Because I was a very masculine girl, long before my sexuality was defined, the adults did not think I had any hope to be married, to become a wife. They hoped very much that as I got older, I would outgrow my foolish gender expression and become like all other girls, feminine. But being a masculine girl child made me like a lightning rod that attracts the bolts of lightning in a storm. I grew up with threats of violence and derision, and I was growing up in one of the most reactionary political periods in the United States, the McCarthyite anti-communist period.
作为一个在青春期之前就已经很明显的阳刚的女孩子，家人其实都觉得这个孩子没得救，将来长大一定嫁不出去。而且他们期望说，哎，也许她再长大一点就会觉悟，然后或者回复女人的正轨，然后像别人一样温柔娴熟的做女人。不过由于她维持着她的阳刚的外表、阳刚的个性、阳刚做事情的方式，所以她就变成了好像一个避雷针一样，避雷针不是避雷。 他就吸引了各式各样的威胁、暴力、嘲弄。对于他来讲，那段年代更加的困苦，是因为50年代同时也是麦卡锡的白色恐怖年代。
I was born in the same year that the workers and peasants of China rose up in revolution. And that uprising, the most gigantic social upheaval yet in history, touched my life in ways that even a little factory neighborhood in New York State could not hide. I did not know that the same rulers of my country who owned the steel factories that lit up the sky at night and who employed my father and other men to build the electric parts that would be used for military helicopters to attack the Vietnamese people. I did not know that these same people were enraged that the Chinese people would try to break their shackles.
当时的话，这个社会的变革已经强大到使得远在这个中国社会的社会变革已经使得远在纽约州水牛城的我都感受到了那个变化，因为我从前一直不知道美国的资本家们在美国本地建立钢铁工厂，整夜炉火烧的通膨，他们制造的正是攻打越南的军事武器。 而他们美国人竟然在看到中国人民反抗帝国主义的时候还觉得愤怒。
After the World War II, after the United States dropped their weapons of mass destruction on the people of Hiroshima and Nagasaki, they thought in Wall Street and Washington that no one could ever break free from their control. They were enraged that peoples who had been colonized were trying to free themselves from national liberation movements.And what did that have to do with my life? Because in their rage to keep control, they unleashed one of the most terrible anti-communist witch hunts against the people in the United States, against homosexuals, against Jews, against progressive people, against revolutionaries, against anyone who would stand up and speak out.
第二世界大战之后，美国的资本家掌权者其实觉得蛮得意，他们觉得我在长崎、在广岛投下了这个巨大的毁灭的攻击武器以后，那全世界的人应该都看到我展现的实力，以后再也不敢反抗了吧。结果没有想到，全球各地的殖民，原来的殖民地竟然都反抗，反抗殖民主义继续对他们的控制，而开始各式各样的国族的运动。在这个控制这个反抗这个控制的过程当中，美国的这些掌权者他们希望能够控制这样的一个反抗的力量，因此在美国的国内展开了一长串的猎巫行动，对于所有的政治异议分子、犹太人、革命家、进步分子、同志都有非常严肃的政治迫害。
Black people in the United States faced segregation much like apartheid in South Africa. The Pentagon war against the Korean people was in full swing. And when it came to women, they should be seen and not heard. They should be wives and mothers only. Gay people, even if someone was not gay but seemed to be, could be beaten and humiliated and gang raped. And there was only one person who I thought when I was growing upsounded a little bit like me, and her name was Christine Jorgensen. And she's someone who was the first publicized person to have a sex reassignment in that epoch, in that era. And the radios and the commentators, the news, tried to ridicule her out of humanity as though she was not a human being.
五零年代除了白色恐怖之外，还有黑人的种族分离政策正在进行，美国正在进行南北韩之间的战争，当时的女人社会角色被局限为只能做母亲和妻子，当时只要看起来像同志就会被打、被嘲弄，甚至被轮暴。在那个时候放眼四望，我只看到一个人很像我，这个人就是第一个受到媒体关注的接受变性手术的 Christian Jorgensen。 在那个时候，这个消息出来的时候，媒体对他是百般的嘲弄，不把他当个人看。
Most of the gay and lesbian population was underground, was in hiding. But those of us who were considered gender differentHad no place to hide. So we found each other in the factories, in the bars. In those days, it was illegal for two women or two men to dance together in public, but we danced together all the time, and we danced together very, very well.
当时的同志人口多半都是隐于地下躲起来，因为周围都是各式各样的暴力，但是对于性别独特者，一眼就可以看出来他的性别跟别人不同的人来讲，他无处可躲，因为太明显了。他们唯一可去的地方，唯一可能找到慰藉的地方，就是一些酒吧，因为当时的法律甚至上还规定，女人和女人共舞，男人与男人共舞都是犯法的， 只有在地下酒吧里面才找到一点点属于自己的自由空间。
But repression has another side to it, because if you push people against the wall, what can they do except come out to fight back? And that is why the 1960s in the United States were a time of such social movements for change, because it was no accident the 1960s came after the 1950s.That those social movements were a reaction to the period of repression of the 1950s.
虽然有这样强大的压迫，可是压迫的另外一面却是反抗。因为当你把人推挤到无处可走的时候，人们就不得不反击。因此，1960年代跟随着1950年代那样封闭的恐怖的气氛不是意外的。在1960年代美国的各式各样的社会运动兴起，其实正是人民对于压迫的反击。
The rise of the young, what we call the young gay liberation movement, even though it included lesbians, it included, in the leadership, many black and Latina and white poor youth who were defined themselves as drag queens in those days or as butches.Our movement was like a wave that got pulled by other waves before it. The movement for the civil rights of black people in the United States, the women's movement, the movement against the war in Vietnam. These were like waves that pull and make room for another wave, and that's where the gay liberation movement came from. But many of us had learned important politicaland organizing skills from having been part of those other movements as well.
当时同志解放运动历史还是很短，但是其中已经包含了各式各样的同志，有黑人同志、拉丁美洲裔的同志、贫穷的同志、扮装皇后们，各式各样的同志都集结在这个运动里面。这个运动同时也跟其他同时存在的社会运动彼此之间纠结在一起。比方说在他之前已经发生的黑人的民权运动、妇女权益运动以及反越战运动，这一些运动都和年纪比较小的同志运动混杂在一起，也透过参与这些其他的运动，同志运动的成员学会了组织技巧，学会了一些政治策略。
But every young movement, if it's going to know which way forward, has to know where it's come fromThere's an old African proverb that says, until the lions come to power, the hunters write the history. And what the Black Liberation Movement and the Women's Liberation Movement and other struggles did was to dig up the history of the people who had been rendered invisible in the history books in order to see how did we get to this place?And how do we move forward? And I decided I must do this about people like me. I must find out, are Christine Jorgensen, or the drag queens and butches at Stonewall, or those of us who were fighting in the drag bars, blue collar bars of Buffalo, are we the first in history? Or do we ourselves have a path in history?
任何一个历史比较短的运动，年轻的运动，都需要知道它从哪里来，以便知道它要往哪里去。有一句古话说，在狮子上台以前，猎人横行。所以我们需要去挖掘历史，我们需要找到我们作为狮子的力量，我们要知道我们是怎么样变成我们现在这个样子的。在我之前，在我们水牛城酒吧里面的同志出现之前，在我们变装皇后出现之前，在变性人 Jorgensen 出现之前，难道没有别人吗？我们还有什么样的过去的历史能够作为我们的借鉴
？Transgender warriors presents all the research that I could find as a blue-collar, working-class, young butch lesbian who did not finish high school.
各位的大会资料部里面的资料手袋里面都有一本 中央大学性别研究室所编的跨性别，其中后半节的部分就有包含我所写的两篇文章翻译成中文，从跨性别战士中所选择的两个章节，另外还有包含另外一本书一篇文章，这是费雷斯的非虚构小说式的写作第一次翻译成中文。这些文章呈现了我个人作为一个蓝领工人子弟，很年轻的，当时很年轻，很年轻的阳刚的女同志所能够做的一些历史研究。
What I found in my research, I did not start this path. I went back and looked at the work of Frederick Engels on the origins of the oppression of women, which the Marxist feminist current of women's liberation in the United States had helped contribute information to. And I used much of the approach of the continuation of that examination of history of sexual oppression from my own organization, Workers' World Party, which produced the first Marxist analysis of the roots of lesbian gay oppression. So there are people who had already blazed the trees, marked the trees for the path in the forest back into history for me.
在我的研究过程当中，我最先参考的是恩格斯写的《家庭与私有制的起源》。然后这个作品之所以得到我的注意，是因为当时的马克思主女性主义者所提供的一些资料。在这个过程当中，我研究了整个性压迫的历史，也透过我自己作为工人党的一个部分，工人党是当时在美国出版第一本有关于劳动阶级同志历史。透过这一些经验开始累积我写这个跨性别战士的资料。
When I went back and looked at the earliest records of human society on every continent, first the thousands of years of written history, and then the oral histories before that, and the creation stories from all over our globe, what I found wasthat even though what we think of today as feminine or masculine is not the same as it's been in every society and every time, that there seems to have always been a great variance or diversity of gender expression, and that there has always been people who have lived in a sex that appears to contradict their genitals,and that there always appears to have been a beautiful anatomical spectrum between female and male of bodies. But the difference was that all the evidence from communal societies, from cooperative societies, seemed to allow for more paths than the society I lived in did.
当我们回头看人类的历史中的各个文化的时候，当我们回头去看口述史，看各个文化所写出来的这个天地创造天地的故事的时候，我们发现我们一直以为阴柔和阳刚、男性和女性气质就是那回事，可是事实上我们却发现各个文化里面对于什么是阴柔、什么是阳刚、什么是男性、什么是女性特质，其实有非常多元差异的观点。在性别表现方面不但有非常非常多的区别，有很多人甚至他们生活的里面他们活出来的这个性别跟他们的生理是刚好相反的。另外还有很多人也开始注意到，我们其实即使在生理的身体方面性别之内都有很大的差异。在过去共同集采的这个社会当中，其实他们所行走的这个道路跟我们今日的工业社会完全不同。
Wherever I found laws or repression against sexual difference or gender difference or the partitioning of the sexes into two, I found the earliest divisions of societies into classes of have and have-nots and the need to establish paternity, inheritance, and to rule over the multitude by what we call in English divide and conquer, to take diversity and to cut it up into difference in order to make people divided so they can be more easily governed and ruled over.
只要有出现性压或者法律，只要有出现对性别的二分分野，往往在这个社会就出现了以阶级为本的分野，也就是有些人有，有些人没有，有一些是拥有资产者，有一些是一无所有的劳工。这样子的一个方式的话，也在这社会里面形成一种特殊的统治方式。这个统治方式就是分裂，以便统治，把人和人之间划分开来以后，以便用最容易的方式来统治他们。
It would be naive and arrogant of me had I gone back to look at history as though I was looking for people who had the same identity as I did in different cultures, nationalities, regions, and historical periods. I was not looking for psychology or identity. I was not looking to create more boxes than the ones I have to check off on my passport. That bring me to you here illegally as a felon. But instead, I was trying to see whether it's true that there is just one way for human nature to be that is built into us. And in fact, what I found was that what we think of as human nature has changed many, many times with different forms of economic and social organization.
当然，当我研究人类的历史和文化的时候，我并不是很无知的，在找寻跟我一样的人，好像跟我有同样的心理，跟我有同样认同的人，因为我并不想要创造更多的框框，更多的在身份证、护照上面选择的那样子的一个小方块，是男是女，我并不是想找寻这些东西，因为我最主要的是希望透过认识人类的历史和文化，回答一个问题，就是是不是。 我们只有一种存活的方式，是不是性别就是这样子的分野？在我的研究当中，我发现其实人性，我们以为的人性，有很多很多的转变，随着历史产生不同的形式、不同的经济形态，人性也有非常多的不一样的形态。
For many centuries, I found evidence of struggle, of fight back, of people whose collective lives were being enslaved by the privatization of their labor. And in many instances, it was people who were what we would think of as cross-dressed or transsexual who were leading the struggles of all the people for enough food or against slavery or against war. It took many, many centuries for the state and philosophy and education and repression to drive out the knowledge that there are so many ways to be a human being, that it is such a natural part of all of our earliest ancestor societies. And yet, as you see, it's never been completely erased from the culture from below, from the systems of ritual, of belief, of theater, of, in my country, in Halloween. It's an ancient communal tradition that still exists. One day a year, I can't be arrested for dressing this way in the United States.
在这个历史挖掘的过程当中，我发觉很多个世纪以来， 当私有制逐渐夺去了集体生活的可能的时候，人们是会起来抗争的。而在这个抗争的过程当中，我发现了很多的我们现在可以被称为是变性或者变装者，其实是这些抗争的领导人，带着这民众争取对抗私有制对他们生命的掠夺。而有其实花了很多个世纪的各式各样的制度压迫。 追寻才去除了这些领导者的存在，也抹去了他们曾经抗争的历史痕迹。 我们有的时候还在我们文化当中可以偶尔看到一些观念表演仪式或传统的存在，依稀可以看到这一些变性变装跨越性别的行为还在这些仪式当中留存。比方说每一年的万圣节的时候，无论你装扮成什么都不会被警察抓。
And so now these prejudices are woven into the fabric of human thinking, the legacy of centuries and centuries of slavery, of feudalism, and of capitalist rule, and still serve a purpose because they demonize who is considered different, and it diverts attention from what is wrong with the system. How many times I see people who have disabilities being treated as though they are different. And what person is not one accident or one illness away from being disabled? Who amongst us have all equal abilities? Instead, we should be asking, if society was fully accessible, who would be disabled?
然而经过这几个世纪的压迫，歧视已经深深地进入了人类的思考。资本主义形成一个新的思考的奴役制度，在这样一个制度里面，所有的差异都被妖魔化。这样一个妖魔化的做法，其实是使得我们把注意力转到对抗跟我们不一样的人，而不是去认识我们所面对的这样一个社会和制度有什么样的问题。很简单一个例子，残障者常常被视为是差异者，跟我们完全不一样。可是我们哪一个人不是距离残障者只有一次的生病，一次的意外？只要一次生病，一次意外，我们就立刻成为残障者。认识了这样一个现实以后，我们必须要看清楚，是我们的社会制度形成了这样子，让我们对于差异保持敌意。如果我们认识到这样的制度，我们就有机会可以去改变这样一个深入我们思考当中的歧视。
These prejudices like racism and the prejudices against women are very, very deep in society now, and the question is how to uproot them. Education is not enough if we educate one person and one person, because the mechanism of miseducation is much bigger than one person and one person at a time. But a big social movement for changeWhen people come out in the street and say, enough, this is intolerable, this can change ideas through a mass education. And that is what happened in my country with the second wave of women's liberation. I wish I had time to talk about transgender issues in the first wave of women's rights, but that's another conference.
Mutian.种族歧视、性别歧视已经深入人心，我们需要思考的是怎么样能够根除这样子的思考。很多时候教育可能还不够，因为在教育的时候往往是只能救到一个人的思想，一对一的错误的教育、制度的教育充满了各式各样的力量，能够一次就影响到很多人。我们教授就最清楚了。
I have to say
只有透过人们集体的在街头抗争，像美国过去社会运动所立下的这个例子一样，才可能以大量的方式能够改变社会，改变很多人的看法。这也是过去女权运动所给我们最好的一个例子。
I have to defend women's liberation before I make a gentle criticism.Because the right wing in my country is trying to push back all the gains of women's liberation and make it sound like it was something terrible instead of something very wonderful. But now I have to make this little criticism, which is easier to make a quarter of a century later, looking back. And that is that we were able to, through the women's movement,expose how differently the social education of boys and girls begins at birth. But there was not enough looking at how questions of race and nationality and economic class complicated that simple idea of boys and girls. The women's movement was not one voice. It was a river with many currents. It was the most privileged, economically privileged white women who became a dominant current, who tried to make this easy generalization. And of course, movements like each of us make mistakes because movements are made up of us. But there was one other social experiment that was meant to be a good thing, meant to help liberate everyone, but it had a bad side to it, and we had to go through it to understand it. And that was the question of gender expression. There were some in the women's movement who thought, because the attitudes that hold masculinity up very high as a very good thing, and femininity very low as a bad thing, we should get rid of gender expression, and we should only have something that was gender-free called, in English, androgyny. Bufen? But if gang rape and humiliation and beatings and discrimination and imprisonment and police brutality and institutionalization in mental asylums did not make us give up our gender expression, why would criticism make us do that? 当妇女运动决定了这样一个性别表现的中性方针了以后，马上就产生一个问题，因为对于性别表现独特的人来说，如果轮暴、嘲弄、歧视、坐监牢、被送入精神病院矫正都没有办法改变我的性别表现的话，为什么女性主义的批评就能够做到呢？凭什么？ I believe that the struggle against sex and gender oppression is like two wings of one bird. It makes women's liberation and trans liberation sister movements, but only, I believe, if we can embrace two ideas at one time. One is that your gender expression does not oppress me, nor does mine oppress you. Part of the gift of the second wave of women's liberation in the U.S. to me was a view of how institutionalized the oppression is in the economic system in which I live. And so I believe we should defend each person's right to freely express their gender in any way they choose and enjoy seeing how many ways there are to be a human being. But at the same time, we must very mercilessly examine and expose all the very poisonous attitudes that have become socially imbued in the concepts of masculinity and femininity and rid ourselves of those concepts. I also believe that the lesbian, gay, bisexual, and transgender movement are brother communities. You see, we only have sister and brother for this whole human family, to use his words. Because not everyone who's lesbian, gay, or bisexual is differently gendered, or transsexual, or intersexual. We're like two circles that partially overlap. And I'm one of those people who has a foot in, I'm in the middle of those two overlapping circles, and I feel like a person who has a foot in one of each of two rowboats. Personally, I'd like to not see them go in opposite directions.
就我来说，男同志、女同志、双性恋、跨性别的运动，其实是并肩前进的运动，是兄弟姐妹的运动，而且并不是只有在这个运动当中的人才是在性别上面有一些不同的表现的。像我个人的话，有时候跨在很多不同的这个运动之上，跨在不同运动上的人的话，就很不希望这些运动向着不同的方向前进，因为你也知道，冲过水。
It's a tactical question, really, to me, about building unity between the LGBT, because those who are really enemies, who really would want to take our lives, not just our identities, are those who lump us all together as queer. Queer? Only they don't mean it in an affectionate way. And I believe that the best way to unite is not to say, oh no, I'm not like that, no, no, not like that, but to say, you say we're all together, you're right, we're all together.
那这里有一个非常重要的战略的问题，就是如何在各个看起来不同的运动当中建立它的连线，建立它的统一的一个目标。我们的敌人很多时候，他们不只是要消灭我们的认同，消灭我们的差异的性别，他们甚至想消灭我们的生命。所以我们最主要的，而他们用一个名词，就是称呼我们 queer， 这个在台湾是听起来非常亲爱的名词，自我身份认同的名词，在美国的在英文里面的话是一个践踏的名词，是一个嘲弄的名词。因此，对抗这样子一个践踏我们、分裂我们的体制，我们所做的回应方式。 不是看到跟我们并肩作战的朋友说我不是那样，我跟他不一样，相反的我们会说我们站在一起，没错，我们团结在一起。
I also believe that for us to be able to fight not only defensive battles but to be able to expand our rights, win greater change in society, that we need to build larger coalitions to find our way into larger movements. And every struggle, every community takes place in a political environment and has to shape its tactics based on the climate in which it exists. And right now, the struggle for lesbian, gay, bi, and trans liberation and women's liberation is operating in a political climate of war and racism. And I live in the country that is the belly of the beast. I live in the country that is waging that war against the people of the world. I have a responsibility, and so does our movements. The tasks have been placed before us.
但是在抗争的过程当中，我们不单单只是被动的反击而已，我们需要有更大的串联，跟其他的抗争运动连在一起，同时要认清我们所坐落的这个政治脉络。就我所存在的美国而言，当LGBT 运动、LGBT 的运动跟妇女运动联手连起来的时候，他们共同坐落在一个美国的脉络当中，这个脉络是战争的脉络，是侵略的脉络，是种族主义横行的脉络，也就是我们现在所痛恨的帝国之兽的这个中心。因此我们对抗的也必须是这样一个很大的一个脉络环境，这样一个帝国。
Some say war and racism, what does that have to do with lesbian lives? What does that have to do with transgender? That's something different over here. But I see that in history, the way a movement answersOur war and racism, all of our issues, determines whether a movement moves forward or is crushed. In World War I, which was a bloody colonial war to carve up the world into colonial possessions, there was a big gay trans movement in Germany, and it was starting to educate and become powerful. But they said when the war came,Maybe it's okay to just go along with our own ruling class on this war. This isn't really a gay or trans issue. What would it hurt to go along with it? And what happened? It pushed aside the movement because it made the rulers more powerful. It made the more conservative elements in the movement lie taller in the saddle. Those who were the most progressive or revolutionary became isolated.And the patriotic militarism became like a tank that rolled its treads over the movement.
有人可能会说，有一些社会议题其实跟 LGBT 同志运动没什么关联。不过，在历史中，运动往哪个方向走，运动对于这样一个问题说战争可与我何关，对这个问题的答案，其实就反映了未来这个运动会向前进。或者会倒退消失。举一个很重要的历史的例子，第一次大战之后，第一次大战之前，德国曾经有一个很大的同志和跨性别的运动，推广的非常非常有效，蓬勃的发展。可是当时第一次大战快要开始的时候，他们就在想这个问题，说也许大战跟我们无关吧，也许我们不用回应这个国家往战争前进的这个方向。结果这样一个选择使得当时的统治者壮大，使得当时统治者的军国主义能够横行，也同时它的结果使得这个运动孤立起来，而在爱国军国主义的坦克之下，这样一个看起来轰轰烈烈的同志跨性别运动到最后尸骨无存。
But in the Vietnam War era, when I was a youth, we answered differently. We said yes,happens to one happens to all. This is the truth that our union movement, our labor movement, is built on in the United States, that when one is injured, all are injured. When one has a victory, all have a victory. And so you could find the flags, the banners of the young gay liberation movement with drag queens and butches of all nationalities marching against the Vietnam War. We marched, before we had the rainbow flag, we marched with the flag of the North Vietnamese people, and that was our pride flag. And the Gay Liberation Front named itself in solidarity with the Vietnamese National Liberation Front. Very important. Now it's easy in the United States to be against the Vietnam War. It's over. But it's hard to be against the war that's going on right then at that moment.
刚才提到了第一次世界大战那个同志，德国的同志跨性别运动，因为没有对于战争站一个积极的反抗的立场，结果后来被爱国军国主义碾过消失。可是我们举一个相对的例子，在美国越战的年代，当时的同志运动的回应就非常不一样，因为当时因着公运长期的教导，我们从来就相信一人遭难，大家遭殃。在这样的一个集体的例子之下，当时的同志运动最早开始的时候，在越战年代的时候，还没有彩虹旗，我们就已经拿起了北越人民支持北越人民的旗子，我抗争美国对于越南战争的介入。当时所有的扮装皇后也好，男同志女同志也好，都在北越人民的旗子之下反对越战。同时70年代同性恋运动，其实当时的名字叫同性恋解放阵线，大家都知道这四个字，后面这四个字就来自于越南人民解放阵线，也就是越共的名字。所以当时的话，同志运动在美国帝国主义侵略的战争上面占了一个非常清楚的反对的位置。
We marched in support of the black revolutionaries who were being shot and framed up and put in prison. We marched in support of the Puerto Rican revolutionaries, the youth who were being rounded up and imprisoned unjustly. We marched for women's liberation. We stood up for the Chicano farm workers who were trying to organize a union. We stood up for the young Asian revolutionaries who were under the gun in the United States. And we won tremendous solidarity in return from all of these groups that we still enjoy today in many cases, and that helped make people see, ah, here are allies I did not expect to see, standing up for my struggle. This, I believe, is the antidote. This is the cure for the poison of the disunity that's been placed between us.Is for us to be able to say to each other, I just don't talk about unity, I will demonstrate my unity. When you need me to be your ally, I will be there fighting against your oppression as though it was my own.
当时的同志解放阵线，同性恋解放阵线曾经支持美国黑人黑豹党的革命分子，他们被捕下狱被迫害，同性恋解放阵线支持他们，支持当时被捕的在美国的波多黎各人，支持当时的妇女运动所有所进行的行动，对于当时的农工想要组工会，对于当时工会的抗争，同性恋解放阵线的队伍都在那里，所有这些抗争的时候都看到解放阵线的旗帜出现。在这样一个团结的时刻，这一些原来没有想到同性恋解放阵线会出现的运动，很意外地发现他们有了同盟军，为他们的目的而战，为他们的运动而壮大声势。这样子一个团结的联盟，其实是医治统治阶级在我们中间所散播的分裂毒药最好的解药剂。在这个时候，我们所做的事情不是说我支持你，我和你团结，而是我做给你看，我站在你旁边，你需要的时候，我为你而战。
Today, every issue, whether it's for economic or social justice, is connected now to the struggle against the U.S. war for empire. If you talk about the rights of youth, they're being sent off to kill or to be killed. If you talk about AIDS funding or money for health care, it's all going into the war machine. Disabled rights? The war will disable those it doesn't kill. The war is being waged by that great women's liberation machine called the Pentagon, the same Pentagon that rapes its women soldiers and trains its male soldiers to rape and batter. Whether it's for jobs or education or healthcare or to end discrimination, everything now is an issue about the war too.
其实在今日社会当中，任何的议题都有彼此相连。以美国来讲，我们目前很大的一个集中的对象就是美国政府的侵略行动。我们在这样的一个侵略行动当中，我们反对美国人送年轻人上战场去死，我们反对战争枯竭了原来要送到艾滋防治运动里面的经费，我们反对任何可以使得人们变成残障的这种经费运用，我们也反对五角大厦训练更多的军队，训练更多的军人，其实到了别的地方只是去强暴当地的妇女而已。我们反对美国的军备使用，使得国内的就业情况日渐恶化，使得这个健康保险也破产。在这些事情上面，我们都看到美国对外的侵略行为、战争行为，事实上跟我们每一个人在国内的处境是直接相连。
That's why I'm proud that you see lesbian, gay, bi, and trans rainbow flags in all the anti-war demonstrations all around the world and in the U.S. too, before the war even began, when millions of people came out around the world. Bigger demonstrations than have ever happened against an imperialist war in history. You saw the rainbow flags everywhere, including here in Taiwan. In Workers' World newspaper, we have the photo of G.S. Rath's flag, the rainbow flag, demonstrating here in Taiwan, and it gave everyone great hope and courage to see.
就是因为认清了这个美国战争的不义，所以彩虹旗总是在这个反战的场合出现。今年年初二月，美国侵略伊拉克的时候，全球在战争还没有发生，在美国还在考虑什么时候动武的时候，所有的反战行动已经串联起来，在全世界各地的反战场合都有彩虹旗。即使在台湾，二月十五号，彩虹旗弱势连线庆全会的旗子也曾经在美国在台协会信义路路边上出现，而这个照片后来还被 Leslie 放到工人报上面，在美国所有的工人团体都看到。
And we were not just in the ranks of the demonstration. You could hear our voices from the podium as the speakers at the demonstrations. And people all around the world on C-SPAN got to hear transgender voices, lesbian voices, gay and bisexual voices speaking out in unity against the war. We are globalizing solidarity.
同时我们不但是在台下摇旗呐喊，各式各样的男同志、女同志、变装者跨性别者也都在台上面发表言论，谴责美国的侵略行为。透过电视的广播，全世界都看到了 LGBT 同志群体在战争立场上面所站的坚定的地位。如果大家有去美国在台协会的抗议，也会看到庆全会的陈怡蓉也是挂着彩虹的标志在台上面发表反战的言论。
That's where we've been in history. This is where we are. How do we move forward? I look and see that every country that George Bush and the Democrats in the United States who represent Wall Street and the big businesses, who do they target?Who do they say are the evil countries that the U.S. has to go in and liberate? Ever since the overturning of the socialist country in the gains of the USSR, who are the countries now that are in the crosshairs of the Pentagon? They are all the countries that have either tried to stand up and break away from the imperialist world market, that have tried to have any sovereignty or self-determination, whether that's the Cuban people or the North Vietnamese, the North Korean people, whether that's the Syrians or the Iranians. And it is no secret that U.S. finance capital is hungry to re-enslave one-fifth of humanity, the Chinese people.
In 历史上我们已经走过了这些岁月，问题是我们要如何前进，向着什么方向前进。美国的政客资本家他们所对抗的所谓的邪恶的国家是哪一些呢？自从苏联解体以后，社会主义国家倒地之后，目前美国的政客和资本家他们所对抗的对象，称为邪恶国家的对象，其实就是那些想要脱离殖民主义统治，想要有自己的主导性，想要有自己的独立性的一些国家，不愿意进入资本主义体系被他奴役的国家。例如
I believe they can be changed. It is not a complicated thing to do so, but it is not an easy thing to do so.
正如我在我的历史研究当中所发现的，不同的社会组织其实会创造不同的思想的方式，因此面对战争、种族歧视、封闭的心灵和态度，我相信我们可以改变。这并不是一个很复杂的工作，但绝非一件容易的事情。
The work that all of us do in the world every day is so connected. We are a social people. We are a people that are connected by running the work of the world every day. And we have almost nothing to say about how it is run. In my view, the idea is not to break up these giant network of labor, but to take it away from those who say they own it one family at a time through inheritance.
事实上，在旧社会生活来讲，我们是彼此相连的，我们都是社会人，是我们的工作，我们的劳动撑起了整个社会的生活。作为劳动者，我们却对于如何经营我们的劳动，如何掌管我们的劳动，如何分配我们的劳动无权智慧。我们必须要夺回我们的主权，掌管我们自己劳动。
And you know what this is called? We're not talking about a mystery here. I'm talking about socialism, and that's the word I'm not supposed to come here to Taiwan and say.
讲到这里，大家也许还没想到我要讲的是什么。我要讲的就是大家可能没有意识到我会到台湾来说的四个字，就是社会主义。
So let's say it loud.
大声说了，我在这里就是要讲社会主义。
Because even if you don't believe that socialism is possible, if you don't stand up against red baiting, even if you ask for a nickel, even if you ask for more books in school, they'll call you a communist and you'll be pushed back too.
不管你相不相信社会主义是否会实现，只要你向掌管的人说，我们还需要更多的经费，我们还需要更多的书，我们要更好的劳动条件的时候，只要你有任何的抗争行动，他们就会说你是共产党。
In the United States, from the very tallest buildings on Wall Street, you can hear this message, oh, socialism is not such a good thing, it's not so perfect. What has it done for lesbian and gay and bi trans people? Has it been like magic? Has it changed human beings overnight? Oh no, you don't want anything to do with that system. It's failed, it won't work.Capitalism is the end of human history, they tell us. And I'm sorry to say there are some who call themselves progressive who say, yes, not so perfect. I don't have to defend this.
在美国你常常可以听到很多人，特别是住在那种很高很高的楼里面，在那里工作的人，他们会说，社会主义不好啦，不完美啦，不可能的啦。对于我们 LGBT 团体来讲，也没有什么用处的啦，恐怕不要吧，因为
不是看看神家的历史，有很多国家已经落败了吗？那这个是一个没用的东西了。然后提醒大家说，哎，社会主义没用，资本主义才是人类史的终点，我们应该向这个方向去前进。
To those who call themselves progressive, but say, oh no, I can't support the gains of these workers because this is not a perfect society they've created overnight, we say, what a very comfortable armchair you're sitting in. Why don't you get up and make a revolution in the country that's oppressing the workers of the world?
甚至在运动当中有很多进步分子也持着同样的观点，认为社会主义不完美了，没有什么太大的用处了。在这个时候我就会跟他们讲说，你坐那张躺椅坐得太舒服了吧，站起来搞一搞革命吧，为世界上受压迫的工人做点事情吧。
And to those who live in the thin air on the mountaintop of capital, we say, oh, things are not so perfect in the countries that broke away from your system that you can't exploit anymore, and now you're so worried about gay lives and transgender lives, you want to protect us from socialism. We know these societies are not perfect. You are the ones that gave us the legacy that now has to be thrown off. You're the one that have surrounded these countries militarily and infiltrated them and tried to crush them and embargo them and make war against them. And now you want us to line up with you like you're our great liberators?
对那些站在资本主义高山上的人而说，他像用一大堆反讽的话，就说，现在你们反过来了哈，因为天下已经没有你可以压迫的对象了，所以你现在反过来要来保护我们LGBT, 我们就是同志的人群，保护我们免受社会主义之害。不过我们知道，其实是你们这些资本主义高山上的掌权者，是你们使得社会主义国家落入他们非常艰难的处境，因为你们禁运，停止货物的进出口，你们在各式各样的国际的政治场合上面孤立他们，你们使得他们的人民的生活困苦，而现在你竟然会要求我们 LGBT 的人也跟你一样继承你的传统，来继续孤立这些社会主义国家的人民吗？
These revolutions that have taken place in just a century, less than a century, have been the poorest countries in the capitalist chain that have tried to provide and have provided what the people on Wall Street and the richest imperialist countries say they just can't do.To feed the people, to house the people, to make health care and education free. We say, yes, if there are problems, we don't want to sweep them under the rug. It's just the opposite. We want to study them and understand why. But not so that you from above can tear down socialism, but so we can make it stronger.
这一些所谓邪恶国家其实都是在过去是一百年当中翻身的最贫穷的国家，他们提供给他们人民的是在资本主义国家里面认为完全不可能做到的事情，他们使得人民有吃有住有健康有教育，这些资本主义国家还说他们没办法做到，当然还有一些问题存在，因为我刚才讲过有些很困难的这个禁运的问题啦，封锁他们的问题，当然也是问题，我们也需要研究是哪些问题，可是研究这些问题不是要跟资本家站在一起来说社会主义无望，相反的，我们希望能够使得这些社会制度能够更坚强，更站得住。
Removing the economic competition under capitalism doesn't change old ways of living and thinking overnight. It only sets the stage to do that. A revolution is not a single act. It is a process.And it requires the most conscious revolutionary elements to be able to deepen. When I talked about the tapestry of human thinking being so full of prejudice and old values, it takes time and care to unweave what has been woven for centuries, and it is hard to do when you are surrounded by tanks.
要知道革命 不是一夜之间发生的事情。当你把资本主义的竞争挡在境外的时候，也不会一夜之间社会就会改变。革命是一个过程，它是一个需要深化的过程。我们前面已经讲过，人类的思想是透过很长的过程当中累积起来，织成了一定的经纬。那如今我们要移除原来已经织进去的那些歧视、那些分裂、那些对别人的不友善，我们要重织人类思考的经纬的时候，当然需要很多的时间，需要很多的努力。而这些努力，我们很多时候发现在资本主义国家的强敌环伺之下是很难进行的。
This requires much more discussion. I don't offer this as just a simple thing to say. But we have to create the space to even be able to discuss this. And that's why I thank my hosts for having the courage to create a safe place for us here in the military base of Chiang Kai-shek to be able to talk about the defense of the revolution. Because this is the future of humanity that we're discussing. This is us taking our future and our destinies in our own hands and not having shackles on our thinking as well as on our wrists, not to be afraid to speak out against the powers that be now. Because capitalism is not the end of history. Every ruling class thinks they're the end of history, and then history goes on. The fact is, I leave you with this thought, that ever since the first demand for gay and trans liberation, the left wing of the socialist movement, the most revolutionary elements, have always known this is something important to support. We want to strengthen that left wing. And every single movement of oppressed people that is fighting under capitalism leaves its imprint on the demands for that better world that it is trying to create. And so this is the thought I leave you with, that the Stonewall Rebellion in 1969 against police violence and bigotry that launched this movement was made by people who did not share a common oppression. They were black and Latina and white. They were young. Many of them were sex workers. They were homeless. Some didn't have enough money to eat. But when they united against a common enemy, when they saw each other as allies, shoulder to shoulder, to fight back for each other's lives, they made history. Now it's up to us to make history together. And I say, long live the spirit of Stonewall. 谢谢。
自从同性恋解放的这个呼声出现了以后，美国的左翼的这进步运动就非常清楚的知道这一部分的工作是很重要的，而这部分的工作也就强化了美国左翼的运动。毕竟任何的抗争都会留下一个愿景，就是希望能够有更好的一个世界。1969年十强酒吧，非常著名的同性恋运动的历史里程碑。十强酒吧的这些抗争的行动是反对警方的暴力，反对社会的歧视。当时和警察格斗的这些人并没有一个清楚的共同压迫的愿景或者经验，他们有些是性工作者，有些是游民，有些是黑人，有些是拉丁美裔的人，有些是贫穷的人，有些扮装皇后，有很多的同志。他们当时并不见得有一个很清楚的认知，他们是在共通的一个压迫的势力之下。但是当他们在那一刹那团结起来反抗警方的暴力的时候，当他们有一个共通的敌人的时候，他们却创造了历史，创造了后来我们同性恋运动推展开来的历史。今天我也想留下一个最后的一句话，也就是说， 希望我们大家今日在此也是团结在一起创造历史，希望十强的精神永存。谢谢。谢谢大家，因为我们。